guys, happy Saturday. So now with the slowdown of our Saturday vlogs, a lot of you guys have requested that I do individual videos on my dogs and their story. Now, the first Instagram comment that I ever got to that effect actually made me so excited because I treat my dogs like a part of my family. You know, they are my dog children. I take better care of them than I do myself. And whenever you guys leave kind comments about my dogs, I get so excited. When I put them on Instagram and you guys leave sweet comments, I get so excited. Like, I feel like such a proud mom when you guys welcome them and you love them and talk about them and send them well wishes. So for those of you unfamiliar, I do have 4 dogs. And so what I thought we would do is for the next maybe 4 Saturdays, or maybe skip around here or there, we'll do a little showcase on each of these pups. I'll share with you guys their story, how they came to be, all their nicknames, maybe their favorite things, and why they're in diapers. So if you guys have no interest in dogs or animals, these videos will probably be of no interest for you. This has nothing to do with beauty content. More like beauty of the heart. So I thought we would go in order from oldest to youngest, because that's what a fair mom would do. The baby always gets to go first. Not in this case. In this case, we're going to talk about you, huh, Popo? Popo, would you matter? Say hi to your fans. Can you say hi to your fans? Say hi to everybody. Here, let's get closer so they can see your face. Can you say hi to everybody? Oh, all right. That's kind of rude. They're here to see you. You gonna yawn in the camera like that? What up, bro? Anyway, the Topo is a bilingual Chihuahua. He actually speaks more Spanish, He actually understands more Spanish than English. All of his commands are in Spanish. And he pretends to be deaf if you talk to him in English and he's just not in the mood. So he's sassy. His name is Totopo, which literally translates to tortilla chip. But he has 4,000 other names, from Chima to Popo to... Samantha calls him Bay. But he does. He has so many... My mom has like a little jingle for him. He is 12 years old. I actually got him from a family friend that I used to cater for when I lived back home in California. And so she rescued a Chihuahua that ended up getting pregnant. And he was the runt of the litter. And at that time, my Chihuahua was already 15, the one that I had, Pee-wee. And my mom was like, well, he's gonna die pretty soon, so you should probably get a second one so you're not sad. You know, my mom is very face value, you know, like she's efficient. So I totally thought it was, what's the matter? Who's there? Is somebody there? Who's there? Are you gonna get him? Are you gonna get him? Why are you so good looking though? That's what I want to know. I just need to know why you're so good looking. This is going to be the most informal, unscripted, all over the place video ever. And I already do that enough. Can I put you down for a second? My arm's getting asleep. What are we getting? Is it the killer bird? It's the killer bird, isn't it? I know. Troublemaker. You want to get him? Where are your pupils? Where are your pupils? Are you hunting? Huh? You hunting? I love you, Paul. I will not confirm or deny that I just kissed my dog.
Siéntate. Siéntate. Good boy.
Okay, let's give this video some sort of semblance of organization. So, Totopo was 12. I got him as a baby. I was a nutritionist and a teacher at the time, but I was doing kids' birthday parties. Like, I was catering kids' birthday parties with themes on the weekends. And so one of my mom's good friends would always hire me for her birthday parties. And she ended up rescuing a dog from an uncomfortable situation. The dog comes home, and then surprise, one of the dogs gets pregnant, right? So the dog has puppies. And at the time, I was telling you, my dog, Pee-wee, was already 15, and he was always like a grumpy dog, super healthy, always getting into trouble, always getting injured, but always healthy. And so my mom was like, you know, he's not gonna be here very much longer and you're gonna be devastated. He was your first dog ever. Maybe you should, you know, add like a little friend to the mix so that when this happens, he's not, you know, you're okay. So I was like, all right, sure. My dad was like, nope, not happening. And I've told you guys a million times, I grew up in a very Catholic, very traditional Mexican family. So I lived at home until I got married. Basically, it was like right up until I got married. And so my dad was like, no, I don't need any more dogs in this house. So my mom picks up the dog, puts it in a shoebox, drives home, and she's like, she calls me. She's like, can you come outside for a second? I was like, okay. So I come outside. She's like, you need to walk in with the dog. You walk in with the dog. Your dad can't say no to you. If I walk in, he'll say no. He'll maybe take the dog back. You walk in with the dog, he can't say anything. So I swear to God, my dad was like, he couldn't say no. I'll show you guys a baby picture of why. This nugget looked like a potato, like a little white potato with ears. He was the sweetest dog ever, and he would sleep in laundry piles and in shoes. It was just a lump of love. He was so cute. But he's always been sassy. He's always had an attitude problem. When people come to my home, he won't stop barking. And eventually he stops. And when he stops, he gets growly, and they're like, oh, like, does he like me? I'm like, oh no, that's the happy growl. And they're like, what do you mean that's a happy growl? I'm like, see, he just has many levels of anger. There's not like happy, cranky, angry, aggressive. He's just always aggressive, but it's like happy aggressive, sad aggressive, mildly aggressive. He's not violent, like he won't bite anyone, but he's always cranky. So anyway, we brought him home, and he lived at home with me and my other dog, Pee-wee. I at the time actually had to go to Europe for a few months. I kind of fled to Europe. I was having one of those self-discovery moments in life. I needed to clear my head and I need to be gone for a while. So I left. I was in Barcelona. He was a newborn, like a newborn puppy. And you know what I should do is I should move the camera so that y'all can actually see him, because he's the star of the show. So I was in Europe for a little while, and I was terrified that I would come home and he wouldn't recognize me anymore. Back then, you guys, there was no FaceTime. It was called Skype, and Skype was very expensive. So I didn't get to see him until I actually got back, and it was quite a long time. So I saw him, I got him back. Maybe a few years later, I met my ex, we got married. And one of the biggest stressors in our marriage, and it's gonna sound like such a joke, because we had real life problems in addition to this, like real life, real hard, serious stuff in our marriage. But one of the biggest stressors for me was the fact that he never liked my ex-husband, never. Like, they were oil and water. They could cross paths in front of each other and they'd both like snarl at each other. Like, they hated each other. I don't know if it was like a territorial thing, a jealousy thing, but it was a relationship that never happened. Oh my God, I forgot this massive part of the story. So the Topo had the worst case of a type of mange that eats at the hair follicle. So he was bald, like full on bald. It was called Demodex. So I have like four jobs at the time. My senior dog is still around and healthy. Like he's not gonna go anywhere for a while. And my puppy has Demodex mange. Like he's bald. I took him. My paycheck was basically coming in and out, in and out, in and out, with specialists and vet clinics or whatever. Anyway, I finally found a vet. that was able to cure him from Dimodex. And you don't actually get cured, you just get it under control so that your immune system kicks in and controls the growth of this mite that lives on their skin. And so he had to do, he had to do dips. So these were like acid baths. That makes it sound violent. It's that violent. They were like these chemical baths where they soaked him in there for like an hour and like basically killed off the mite. And it builds up their immune system to help them grow back their hair. It took about a year for him to look normal. I'm pretty sure I have pictures that I could show you guys. I'm gonna dig up an old flash drive from like pictures that I transferred over. Do you guys remember when cell phones had those like mini SD cards? That's what I'm talking about. I have a couple of pictures where you could see he had just like bare red spots with no fur on them. Okay, so fast forward, I meet my ex, we get married, they hate each other. We move to Texas, we're gonna baptize my son. We fly back home, but we leave the dogs with my ex-in-laws, which aren't really big dog people. This one has some sort of catastrophic traumatizing event that causes him to have a spinal stroke. Now, with Chihuahuas, you're not supposed to elevate their excitement too much because they can have problems with their heart. They can suffer a heart attack, they can suffer a stroke, an aneurysm. So if you see a Chihuahua that is very high anxiety or is very nervous, don't make it worse. Don't tap on the glass. Don't rattle the fence, don't poke him, leave him alone, because you can actually force him into a heart attack. I don't know what happened, I wasn't home, but he had a horrible spinal stroke on Friday. We didn't get back until Sunday. Our in-laws didn't tell us because they didn't want us to get worried, they didn't want to ruin the trip. But when I came home, he was just completely paralyzed from the waist down. It was one of the hardest things I had ever had to witness with one of my dogs. I mean, from the waist down, he was like the Little Mermaid. All he could do was just drag around. So, you know, he had gone to the potty all over himself. He was just a mess. One thing that I will brag about my ex and I will never take away from him is when it came down to the dogs, he wasn't a dog person, but he knew how much of a dog person I was. So it was like, whatever you need, that's fine. You know, whatever it takes. And so we ran around all over DFW between physical therapy and to Mansfield and Grapevine and Plano. And we had so many different specialists. Like this kid was getting CT scans, MRIs. He was doing water therapy. We were in appointments and appointments and appointments. And I remember when our expense got to $7,000. He had the talk with me where he was like, I know you would never put a price on your dog, but do you think we should have the talk of how much is too much? And that's the moment where I realized that they weren't dogs to me. You know, they were me. They were my kids. They were my purpose. They were what kept me company in Texas, you know, being by myself. They were my family. And I said, I don't have a price. You know, as long as it's within reasonable health recovery, there's no price for me. You know, if obviously he has a horrible accident and, you know, he's mangled or he will never recover or he's in pain or in discomfort or whatever, I mean, come on, you know? But if a doctor's telling me he has to continue physical therapy for the next 6 months, and every time I take him in, it's gonna be $120, I'm gonna do it. And I'm gonna figure out a way to do it, you know? And that's always what's driven me, is growing up in poverty, I've just always wanted to give the people in my life a better life, including my dogs. So my ex was very, very amazing throughout the entire process with like the shuffling back and forth. I mean, we were driving all over the Metroplex for hours, you know, every week, getting him to all his appointments. And I'm happy to say that he went from zero motility from the waist down to about now he's at about 90% recovery. So he'll still do like a little limpy hop, or on days where the temperature changes very drastically, he's uncomfortable. And prefers not to move a lot, and I understand, you know, so we just make him as comfortable as we can. Now, With him, it's been unfortunate just because he is the most senior of our senior dogs. He is 12. And so along with age come other complications like his heart murmur. He also has an enlarged prostate, which is why he wears a diaper. A lot of you guys ask me, like, why is he wearing a diaper? Is that a belly band? I'm like, yeah, it's a band. It's like a diaper for boy dogs. So instead of it, you know, having like a little tail hole and like little leg holes, it just wraps around the midsection. So it kind of squeezes in his little, you know what I'm saying? And he doesn't dribble. So he doesn't mark in the house. He's not a marker. He's never been a dog that pees in the house. But because of his enlarged prostate, he does kind of dribble, so he wears a diaper. It's not often, you know, like his diapers don't really get dirty, but it's a house that we have to live in as well. And even though they are family, they are my life, they are animals, and I don't want to be rolling around in urine, you know what I'm saying? Anyway, just recently though, if you guys have been following our journey on Instagram, in March, they discovered that he did have a heart murmur. And in the last 3 months, the level of the heart murmur increased significantly. So he went from a grade 1 to a grade 3. And it's interesting because I actually took him in to have an x-ray done just to see deeper into the murmur. But as the appointment was approaching with the specialist, he started to develop a cough. So our appointment comes around and he's had a cough for about a week, and the cough just gets progressively worse, and it's dry and it's like, it's wheezy. it sounds painful. So I tell the doctor, we have a great doctor at Banfield, and I tell the doctor about his situation. They check him out. It turns out that the cough came from his enlarged heart pushing on his trachea and causing him discomfort, hence the cough. The cough got worse because he was having discomfort in this sort of area because of the heart, he started to develop fluid in his lungs as well. And so in a matter of like a week, he got pretty sick. So reviewing his chart and the progress of the murmur, he is currently on 3 medications. One of them is not very good for him. It's just to like instantaneously shrink down his heart. And the reason his heart is so big is because the murmur is causing him to not be able to close a valve properly. So all the blood rushes in, but he can't push it out and keep it out. So it won't close and keep the blood out. It just builds up. And it makes his heart bigger. Now, I will have to say that after being on the medicine for 24 hours, his cough went away. So we're hoping, fingers crossed, you guys, that after he completes the 2 weeks of this medication, we can take him off of it. But he will have to be on the remaining 2 medications for the rest of his life. Now, according to his doctor, he is not in pain or discomfort. It's just something that comes along with his size and his age. It's normal. I've actually never had a dog with a murmur before, so I don't know what to expect. So I hear congestive heart failure and I freak out, you know? So right now he is not in congestive heart failure. His other organs are compensating for the struggle of the valve right now. However, if his organs get tired of helping the heart, then he will go into heart failure, and that's when we have to start thinking about, you know, his quality of life and the medication that he's on and stuff. So a lot of you guys reached out to me and were like, my dog has a murmur, my cat has a murmur, they've lived with it for years, I promise you it'll be okay, just love on him, he'll be fine, it's totally normal. Like, you know, prayers, well wishes. You guys, I have never felt so much love from you guys than what you guys expressed for the Topo. I told them I had to. I was like, the Topo, let's go through your messages. Oh, and then they said this, and then they said that. I don't know if he knows, but I know he feels it. But I wanted to take a couple of minutes to thank you guys for, you know, being a part of my family, because I share as much as I can and as much as I feel comfortable, but you guys give me as much as you can and as much as you know will make a difference. So I just wanted to say thank you. I appreciate it so much. But that's the Topo story. He has always He has always made his presence known, whether it's through a growl, a bark, an illness, wearing a diaper. He is handsome, you know. The funny thing is that when he was younger, he only liked me and my mom. That was it. Those were the only two people that he liked on this world, in this world. Then he met Sam, fell in love with Sam, and now as he's gotten older, he's become such a mush that anyone that comes to my house, he'll kind of bark a little bit, and then he'll give him like the side eye, like the big giant Karopi side eye, and then he likes them. And then you can't get rid of him. Like, he'll just go and he'll plop himself on your lap, and you basically have a chihuahua now. So, I have a very special connection with the Topo because he is my last little bit of home. You know, he is my last little bit of who I was before any of my life changes, before I became a mom, before I became a wife, before I became a divorcee, before I became a Texan. He is my last little bit of who I am or was years ago. So I look at him and I see home, I see California, I see my parents, I see my old bedroom. I see those visits to the specialty clinics, you know, to fix his Demodex problem and all of the stuff that happened before all of the stuff happened with me, you know? It's just, it's such a weird explanation because you're like, Danny, it's a dog. It's a chihuahua. What are you talking about? But I just, he's home to me, you know? And so whenever anything happens with him, I think it hits me harder than with any of the other dogs. He's very special. Anyway, so that is it for the Topo's story. I really hope that you guys enjoyed it. I am going to do the same exact video with the three other dogs in my life. I really hope that you guys will like it. I know it's personal and it's probably super random and useless to your life, but they are a part of my life and you guys seem to enjoy getting to know me a little bit better. So that's the Topo story. Next, we will do Wesley's story. He is next in line, the other boy, the big chubby Westie. I will leave a playlist in the description box below so that if you're seeing this video out of order, the other videos will be there as well. But yeah, this is my dog. If you guys want to know what belly bands he uses or diapers, I will also link those in the description box below. But I think that's it. I feel like I need to wake him up so that he can say bye to you guys. Hey, Topo. Popo, me papa. Amiga, coisa de mi vida. Domingo. You see how he respects me? Do you see that? Like, he's like coming running to his mom.
Man, man, papito.
Watch. This is a happy growl. Do you hear that?
Hey, can you say bye to your fans? Say thank you for loving me and for caring about me.
I know you don't understand English.
Diles gracias. Los amo, muchas gracias por apoyarme y tenerme amor y cariño. Los quiero mucho. Diles, los quiero mucho. Saludos, abrazos, bendiciones.
He's just saying thank you and blessings and I love you and hugs and kisses.
Hapapo. Con el amor de mi vida. Con el retorno del amor de toda mi vida. Eres tu vida, papá. Say, if you found this video useful, entertaining, and learned something, please give us a paw up.
And subscribe if you haven't already. And until next time, this Topo break is over. Bye, guys. Go.
Diles bye.
Diles bye. Diles bye. Eres truco de retorno mi vida. Retorno de mi vida. Porque sí. I love aggressively. Okay, you guys. Ay, cuida de mi vida.